What an interesting session that was, and I'm only looking around the names of Sonja's with us, so we're going to turn to Sonja almost immediately. But, and I forgot to ask Mate Granic a question that I'm going to ask Sonja and even indeed Nena. That was a hugely complicated, Dayton is a hugely complicated peace agreement. And you actually get a sort of first-hand insight into it because of the extraordinary ability of the BBC to put that program together so quickly. The question I forgot to ask Mate Granic was, do any of those guys, apart from him, of course, come out of it well viewed overall? It's a sort of question I think that Amir might have been getting close to when he was asking about negotiations, and maybe Adam as well. Was it Adam who was asking about practicalities? To what extent are these people, when they exercise this massive power over the interests of villagers, townspeople, here, there, and everywhere, who have absolutely no power personally over the negotiating process, to what extent are those people who do have the power just playing a practical game, in a sense? Or are they really motivated by the best interests of those they represent? It's a jolly difficult question to ask and answer. And for those of you who are not from the region, I should have explained earlier, in case you hadn't picked it up, that whatever the short-term expectations were for BiH, it remains a fully independent and the only independent governed city, I think, in Europe of our present day. Enough of that from me, unless anybody wants to contribute now, and I haven't seen anything on the chat. We're now going to turn to Sonja. Sonja, are you with us? Sonja, are you there? You may be there, Sonja, but unless you... there we go. Now, Sonja, I'm sorry if Mate Granic has taken rather longer than expected.
No, it's okay. He was very interesting.
And so would you give us a fairly short opening to what you want to talk us about? Because I have no doubt we can proceed either by way of presentation or indeed question and answer. But do remember that some of us are less familiar with the detail than you are. So if you can make it at a measured pace, that would be great. Okay. Thank you very much, Sonja. Off you go. You've all read about Sonja. You know who she is, the brave life she led, and the fact that she's got a dog, and that she was only able to exercise the dog between midnight and 2 o'clock in the middle of the pandemic. Sonja, thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you. We have been talking about Bosnia now for a whole week almost, about all these agreements and what has happened in the field. But I would like to focus on the Serbian project, which is still persistent. I mean, we talked about Serbian strategy in Bosnia during the war, but this strategy still exists. And this is why all these agreements, like Dayton Agreement, is not functional, because Serbia never gave up its aspirations in the region. Serbia never acknowledged the reality in the region, despite that all these new states are internationally recognized, and Serbia itself in the borders that we have today. So in order to understand what is the Serbian rationale or logic behind this strategy, I would like to make just a few introductory comments about how it all started. Already in the 19th century and throughout the 20th century, Serbia always perceived not only Bosnia, but also Yugoslavia as a Serbian extended state. Of course, the second Yugoslavia was up to its taste up till 70s when decentralization.
Sonja, forgive my interrupting you. Just in case some of, particularly our perhaps English members aren't aware, the project for what is known in shorthand as Greater Serbia may have other names, and that name may not be right. When was it first articulated? And was it articulated in public or in private?
Well, I would say that Constitution 1974 and the amendments which were discussed since...
No. Sorry. I'm so sorry. So sorry. The 19th century. You told us this is a project of long... When was it first formed in the 19th century? And was it public or was it private?
Well, I think it was private, but apparently this is something that has been living in the minds of a Serbian nation, because this is how it was presented, that Serbia will liberate all Serbs in the region, and Serbia considered itself as the backbone of the Balkans. That's how already in the 19th century and beginning of 20th century, they see themselves as a legitimate, how should I say, state, which would unite the Balkans in one state, because all other nations in the region didn't have a statehood experience. Therefore, they thought it would be something that was their task. And during the very foundation of Yugoslavia was their first chance to see, to implement their, how should I say, vision of this state, very centralized, dominated by Serbian institutions, Serbian military, Serbian police. But unfortunately, the at that time, other nations were not able to impose their own concept, because they were just starting a new life in a new state. And of course, you have to bear in mind that we had two very confronting civilizational experiences, Austro-Hungary and Ottoman Empire. So whereas Slovenia and Croatia were much more ahead of the Serbia in terms of economy, culture, and so on. And very often you will hear here that at that time, most of the industry, most of the money, 75 or 80% were in Zagreb, not in Belgrade. So from the very foundation of the country, there was this dissatisfaction, how it was run and so on. Second World War, I will just put it in short, brought this new concept of federal state, which was installed by Communist Party. And after the Second World War, it was a highly centralized federation, similar to one of Soviet Union. But slowly, over the years, this pressure for decentralization became so strong that they have changed the constitutions over the years. And I think all showed how there was this kind of search for the balance in the federation, for the balance of equality and so on. And in 68, they started to discuss amendments which ended up in the new constitution, 1974, which was really introduction into this confederal concept of Yugoslavia, and also the concept of, I would say, changed contract among Yugoslav nations. At that time, Serbia was already...
Sonja, yeah. Sorry to interrupt you, but you tend to go quite fast, and it's probably me, actually. My brain isn't that flexible anymore. But can I just ask you a question in a very pictorial way, really? A concept that I sometimes use, having no connection apart from the work I've done with the region, possibly adopted by Nena, who will be listening, is that the Serb project is a bit like a railway train, and it has different drivers at different times coming on, trying to take the project forward. And then when they fail, getting thrown off and replaced by someone else. What happens, you're up to now to 1974. So that's before Tito, who'd held Yugoslavia together, was ill and died in 1980. Was that project, if we're right about it, this concept of a railway train or a bus or something waiting for a driver, was it still underway, if invisible, or had it been set aside by the Serbs?
No, Serbs have already started their preparation for the after Tito's death period, mm-hmm. already in 66, once Brioni session was sort of getting away with the police, repression, not only in Kosovo, but there was this, I would say, preparation of Ranković, then Minister of Interior, as a leader of who would replace Tito. So that was already very live in Serbia. And at that time, when Tito replaced Ranković, Dobrica Čosić, who is not only a famous Serbian writer, but also a nationalist ideologue, he wrote a letter to Tito telling him that he made a great mistake and that Serbian nation will never forgive him for removing Ranković. So since then, and then at that time, you had Dobrica Čosić, mentioned a few other people who were opposing Kosovo development at that time, student demonstrations, which was really introduction in something that will happen later on in 81, rebel against the position of Kosovars. And after 68, they were, how should I say, given all this infrastructure, which apparently initiated the development of their elites, academic and all others, but especially academic, because Kosovo University was established in Pristina, and they were the ones, this generation was the one which really prepared Kosovo for the independence and what has happened later on. But Serbs at that time quite conscious that they would not be able to control neither Kosovo or any other republic, they started to prepare their project, I would say openly. It was not public in terms of written programs and so on, but the atmosphere in the society was such. I remember that as a young person, when they would say, this is ours and this is that, it looked like as if they were joking at this public, how to say, events, flowers, cafes, because cafe tradition is very, very strong here in the Balkans. So you could hear all kinds of, stories about what will happen after Tito's death. And after the Constitution 74 was declared, they started to very actively prepare, and this is the circle around Dobrica Čosić and Academy. So it shows that really academic elite was the one which apparently prepared the project, not Milosevic. Milosevic was just installed to implement the project. So after Tito's death, there was immediate sort of, very active and open lobbying of Serbian intellectuals and Serbian elites for this, project of decentralizing Yugoslavia under domination of Serbia. At that time, we also had some kind of dialogues about what Yugoslavia should look like, and it was rather very dynamic discussion. But after a memorandum in 1986 was made public, in Serbia itself, all other discussions about future of Serbia somehow disappeared. Also, there was another very important paper. It is about Kosovo, which was signed by 232 intellectuals at that time, maybe even more important than memorandum. And these two papers together were really introduction in homogenizing Serbian nation for what will come later on.
Nena, can we just pause there, Sonja, because there's a great deal of cultural detail here that some people won't fully recognize. Now, the memorandum to which you've referred, which is a document of extreme importance, actually comes from not a political party, but from
intellectual elite, academic elite.
The academic elite. And would I be right in thinking that to some extent, in the one-party state that was operative under Tito, the Academy of Arts and Sciences in this memorandum was fulfilling a political role that in other countries might be taken by political parties?
Well, I cannot say that it was one party system, because we had eight party system. Each republic had its own party, and each autonomous province had its party. And there were a lot of, I would say, one kind of pluralism, which was unusual for this socialist or communist state. Whereas in Serbia, I mean, it was quite clear that you had this, unified position about the future of Serbia. So I would say, in order to prepare the nation, to condition the nation for what will come later on, it was important to, and that was very successful, to promote the project through the culture. And culture was very important for mobilizing and homogenizing people. So we have all kinds of books, theater plays, films, public gatherings. So it was so present that you couldn't hear anything else, although there existed some other lines, but they somehow lost the presence in the public. In 1988, after all these documents were set forward, the fierce campaign started by the through media, which were all centralized and controlled by Milosevic. She had a special team, about 20 people, who were on daily basis planning what will be lived on that very day. So There were two very important directions in this campaign. One was towards Croatia, and the other one was to Bosnia. And of course, the first victims of this propaganda invasion were the relays. So they occupied the relay, a very important relay in Bosnia. So they had the control over the space in Croatia and Bosnia. And the main argument for preparing Serbs for this, what will happen later on, was that there is a new genocide being prepared against Serbs in Bosnia and Croatia. And of course, they used a lot the Second World War genocide against Serbs in Jasenovac. So this was magnified and was really serving to mobilize emotions of Serbs throughout the region and conditioning them for what will come in very short time. And the church, Serbian Orthodox Church, was very instrumental in this, going throughout all these mass graves in Yugoslavia and, you know, spreading this fear of next genocide and so on. And I would say that the Serbian Orthodox Church never recognized the Republican borders, and they claimed...
Well, I think, again, Sonja, since you're taking a glass of water and working on the basis that not everyone will know this, when you say they didn't recognize Republican borders, those of us looking from outside at a map with the borders of the republics before the split up into what it was six, what was it, eight and now, whatever it is, nine composite parts. Seven. I muddled again, can't count. But tell us just briefly how these original, or not original, how these borders that we would have found on the maps came to be and why they weren't recognized.
Well, I think the borders are more or less logical. And there was a commission for borders, which was set up after the Second World War, was headed by Gilas, who was a famous dissident who splitted from Tito in 1952 or three. And apparently all these entities called republics were more or less the historical entities where maybe some border changes were, they never existed as states, but as regions, yes. And this was something that was accepted by all republics. Serbia didn't accept, I mean, some of Serbian nationalists didn't accept it because they thought that wherever Serbs live, like in Croatia or Bosnia, they're considered as Serbian lands. But as I said, after the Second World War, because it was highly centralized federation, it somehow appealed to Serbia because it allowed them to be still dominant in the state because they were relatively the biggest nation in the country. But over the time, this pressure from the republics grew, and of course, it resulted in changes of constitutions. And I would say the changes of constitutions really represent this search for modus vivendi among these nations and republics, which later on, or the states, national states. Mm. Well, as I said, this media campaign was really aimed at conditioning Serb nation for what will come. On the basis of the Second World War atrocities against Serbian nation, and this worked out. And we heard a lot about what was happening during the war and how Serbia was really getting an upper hand because of dominating Yugoslav army and other repressive mechanisms.
I'm just going to interrupt you very briefly to check with the audience who can indicate by a show of hands, and we'll do it in the negative. Is anybody not aware of the problem for Serbia in the Second World War at the hands of the fascist state, the Ustasha? Anybody not aware of it? Okay. Thank you very much, Holly. That means we just need a very brief explanation of that, please, Sonja, because otherwise we can't move forward. Okay. So very quickly,
okay.
The fascist state and the massacre of the Serbs, Roma, Gypsies.
During the Second World War, Serbia was split up between different states, between Bulgaria, Hungary, Germany, Italy, and so on. And Croatia was set up as a statelet, which was with the leader Pavelić, who was really installed by Germans, and they carried on the program, the project of ethnic clean state, and which aimed at 1/3 of liquidating Serbs, 1/3 of cleansing them, and 1/3 of converting them to Catholicism. And this ended up in huge atrocities, especially in few camps like Jasenovac. And Jasenovac was very much debated in Yugoslav public and they in the Serbian society and its intellectuals claiming that there were 700 Serbs who perished, where the real figure is about 80,000, 85, and there were two very known Yugoslav scholars, one Serb and one Croat, who apparently came to the same figure of perished people during the Second World War, including the Jasenovac. But despite all these facts, Serbia really magnified the figure, and it's still today very much present in our debates here. Whoever dares to say the exact number is sort of called as marked as a traitor and so on, pro-Croatian, Ustasha, and so on. So this worked very, very, very efficiently, because there was not an effort to reconcile the two nations, to sort of explain what has happened and so on. Instead, it was really used for the aims of the war, which was about to start. And regarding the Muslims, they were portrayed as Islamic fundamentalists, especially since 1970s, when Muslims were declared the nation, Muslims, because Bosnia was always the aspiration both of Croatia and Serbia especially, and the Yugoslav state decided to, and this was a process of emancipation of the Muslim community, so they were given this status of nationhood, and that was something that Serbia has never acknowledged, and over the these two decades, they were really, through books and all kinds of debates, qualifying Muslims as a rotten nation, as a nation which is apparently Serb, which converted to Islam. And all these negative stereotypes were built up, and especially the fact that Muslim population had a bigger demographic natality, and it was a danger which Serbs perceived as something that would outnumber Serb nation in the region, both in Kosovo and in Bosnia. So
pausing there again, as to the Jasenovac and other places of alleged killings of the Serbs and others by the Croats, although the figures may be doubted, there is absolutely no doubt that it happened. So this was a
genocide,
a possible real cause for historic, but a real cause for grief.
Yes.
The other characterizations, for example, of the history of the Muslim people and whether they were separate or not, that's much more contentious. But so there's a mixture of the real and the arguable. Would that be fair?
The fact is that Serbs the Serb elite use all kinds of arguments, territorial, historical, mythology. So it was really a mixture of different kinds of approach to certain situation. Either it was related to Kosovo, Bosnia, or Croatia. However, they somehow managed to sort of create this moral atmosphere for what will happen. And this is still today in place. So it's, and of course, this Muslim demographic explosion was something which was much debated in academia, and it was there were all kinds of roundtables which discussed how to curb this demographic explosion, which also introduces us to the fact that reducing the number of Muslims in Bosnia was one of the aims. And this is how, especially in Eastern Bosnia, where the dominant population was Muslim, about 80-90%, and genocide really happened there. Real genocide happened in Eastern Bosnia, including Srebrenica and Jepa and all and the surroundings. So this is something that was already in the air. It's and if you follow what was written in there, like this famous academic Matsura, he was a very known Yugoslav demographer. He was really the one who was planning and advising to Albanian women and other Muslim women how to stop their sort of natality, how to reduce their natality. So you can see that natality or number, demography was a key, one of the key considerations in how to deal with Muslim population in Bosnia. So in 1992, there was a Congress of Intellectuals in Sarajevo, Serbian intellectuals. They wrote a declaration about separation of the three nations in Bosnia. In 1994, there was another Congress of Serbian intellectuals in Belgrade, which concluded that unification of Serb nation is imperative. And it hasn't changed since then. After the Dayton Congress, most of the intellectual elite was very much against it because they considered that it was unfair, that Serbs had lost their territories and so on. But very soon they decided or realized that Dayton was the maximum they could get in the international context. But already since 1997, they started to get organized. How to preserve Republika Srpska as a military game and how to prevent any kind of return of refugees, Muslims and Croats to Republika Srpska. And Annex 7 of Dayton, in my view, is something which was crucial in order to prevent changing of this demographic structure in Bosnia. But unfortunately, international community was not focused on this issue. In 1997, this year was declared as the year of return of refugees to Bosnia. All those who returned to their entities, Serbs to Republika Srpska, Muslims to the part that they got, and Croats there. So in fact, return of refugees in a way cemented or consolidated ethnic division. So, and there after the-
Let me just understand that.
Yes.
You say the return of refugees consolidated ethnic division. You're not presumably arguing in favor of the refugees not being allowed to return, because
but they were not allowed to return to their domicile places. This is the fact, and this was exactly the strategy of Serbia in 97. They had the round table and they published this book after that. This is Geopolitical Reality of Serbs. And this book contains documents which refer how to keep Republika Srpska away from Bosnian state, how to prevent any kind of integration. Here you have everything as a strategy, which was later on developed, especially after 2008. And of course, Serbia in 1998, 1999, 2000, you know, the high representatives, especially after the 2000 Pedi Erjan, they managed to somehow push Bosnia into some kind of integrative processes, especially Pedi Erjan was very successful. But after his departure, I think, especially after 2008, when Kosovo declared its independence, Republika Srpska intensified disintegrative processes. Dodik was always arguing.
Before we move on, and we're moving at a great pace, and thank you for that. There's one question I don't think I've ever asked you, despite all the years I've known you, Sonja. And Naina may want to contribute this to this as well. You've looked at the developing problems, if that's the way to describe it, from the point of view of the Serb hegemonic ambitions and the long-term 19th century as a minimum Greater Serbia plan. But there are other indications, both from the nature of the agreements, but also from explicit references, for example, in a book called The Clinton Tapes, which are interviews with Clinton after he'd left office, that the West simply did not want a Muslim state in the heart of Europe.
Yeah, that's true.
Do you, first of all, do you accept that there are these two different...
Well, I think that during the war, none of the, especially European Union, also United States were hesitant to get involved. Finally, they did, especially about around Srebrenica and Dayton Agreement. They, you know, by inertia, all these European states, especially the older ones, UK and France and so on, they somehow acted by inertia. Each of them sort of advocated the interests of the states they were more involved with, like I would say Britain with Serbia, and Muslims were perceived as were part of this European Islamophobia, I would say, and it was considered that it was by no way possible to allow Muslims to create a state under their domination. And unfortunately, all these mediators in Bosnia, David Oven and Stoltenberg, apparently were carrying these maps all the time. And one of the Serbian leaders said, we had the maps and the gun, and all these mediators who were in Bosnia, they also carried the gun and the maps. So there was no way that they would engage in other kind of agreements. It was on the table all the time. And I would say it was suggested, especially by Serbian side, that we cannot live together. They accepted that, and that also reflected on the return process. That, I mean, that all these people who left Bosnia and later on returned home or in Croatia, where the one, it was really something that it was accepted that their return would be minimal or would be would not be relevant in terms of reconstructing social fabric of the Bosnian society. So and Serbia was really very insistent, and I would say the general international context very much played into its hands, especially after 2008 financial crisis, when European presence in the region was really, in a way, very slow, very reluctant in many ways. Everything that was promised at the Thessaloniki summit in 2003 about the membership of these states was really prolonged, and new criteria, new standards were imposed and so on. Whereas the region really needed quick recovery in order to be able to come to terms with what has happened during these devastating war years. And Serbia, in the meantime, quite convinced that they can get away with their aspirations, came up with a strategy which was passed by democratic government of Boris Tadic in 2001. It is a strategy about how to deal with the diaspora in the region, meaning with the Serbs in Bosnia, Croatia, Montenegro, and Kosovo. And this is on the site of our government still. So this document speaks about how to preserve Serbian ethnic territories in the neighborhood, how to integrate them in Serbian economic, cultural, informative space, because politically speaking, at that point, it was not possible. It was not the right moment for unification. Therefore, and Serbian Orthodox Church, which is a legal institutions in all these states, was the main, institution or instrument to achieve these goals. And it's not unusual that Serbian Orthodox Church plays this role nowadays in Montenegro. It's not about law on religious communities. It's really a political struggle between Serbian Orthodox Church, which is state within state in Montenegro, and Montenegrin state. So this was very successfully implementing all these years. And last year, there was a new document called Charter on the Serbian cultural space. And this is all how it started back in 70s. Now they only recycled the titles of the documents, you know, union, cultural space, integration, and so on. So you can see that this is on the table all the time, and that all these peace agreements have a problem in implementing and lack of political will from the international community, because the international community is guarantor of these peace agreements. Dayton Agreement, Kumanovo Agreement, the only successfully implemented agreement is the Erdut Agreement, reintegration of peace into creation state. So, Sonja,
I'm going to slow you down again, because we're all having to move at the speed of your thinking, and sometimes we need to slow you down. Now, I rather hope that Naina might be...
Just a minute.
I want to ask you a question. And I hope that Naina may be able to contribute, because where we've reached so far raises for me a couple of questions, one of which is a Naina topic, and she may be able to deal with it directly. Ah, there she is, which is about the effect of all the agreements which you've just read out, or some of them which you've read out, being agreements whereby populations would have to be moved. Now, those agreements were not necessarily driven by Serbs. They may, however, have played into the Serb hands. And so I'd like Naina to ask you a question about that. But before that, and entirely on a tangent, because I know, Sonja, you spend a great deal of time in Kosovo, which is a nominally Muslim state. I hope I'm not offending several Kosovo members by referring to it as a nominally Muslim state. It is not a very overtly Muslim state. And I want to know whether you see any connection between what happened to the Bosnian Muslims and also what may be happening to the Kosovo Albanians. But Naina, do you want to deal with the issue I raised that is very much your topic?
True, it's a difficult because it doesn't follow the flow of this morning's conversation and Sonja's topic now, in the way that outsiders exist, and huge apologies to our listeners today, because you can imagine that and Sonja and I and Jeffrey and I, we spend a lot of time talking about all these things, and we have certain speed, you know, that I don't think the rest can follow us. But I will tell you the following awakening for me. You know, when I was tasked to work on monstrosities committed by Serb individuals that represented Serb politicians and Serb leaderships in the wars, you concentrate on evidence that is coming your way, and you do not necessarily look into the larger picture, what is really happening. So what happened to me is that I was writing my PhD, and it gave me different sort of overview on the evidence that went through my hands many, many times. And I remember a moment that in panic, I called Sonja and Jeffrey, and it was already about how long it could be, more than 6 years. So I'm not quite sure. And you know what I discovered? I discovered the following, that each of the countries that were involved in a war ended up in the war being more ethnically homogeneous than before the war. Croatia went from 12% of Serb population to 4% currently. Exactly the same happened in Kosovo. Kosovo is more ethnically homogeneous, and Bosnia is in a way more ethnically homogeneous because we have this internal division. So the first question as a researcher you have, how did it come about? Why these results are so similar? And then for the first time, I went in this way through the peace proposals that I showed to you. And my first discovery was, how was it possible that the first peace agreement for Bosnia and Herzegovina launched, but then still European Community by this Troika, as they call it, three ministers of foreign affairs leading foreign policy of all members. So Kudlero plan ethnically separated Bosnia in different areas before these ancient hatreds, enraged people decided to kill each other, which was a sort of popular way to describe why violence was so severe. So you simply saw that there is a huge overlap, what at least European Union and later America apparently also wanted to achieve. For which reasons? Maybe they saw that ethnically more homogeneous post-Yugoslav states would be more stable. But what absolutely shocked me, and why I called Jeffrey and Sonja in this panic, when I realized that ethnic separation and lack of permanent political solution for Kosovo and Bosnia and Herzegovina might have a different reason. Maybe, and there are indications that Western participators in the negotiations, as Mate Granic explained, actually wanted Kosovo and Bosnia to end up as internally divided because they had an interest to minimize role of what they saw at that time, political Islam. And the fact that Bosnia is not functioning state is maybe not just a negative impact of poor constitution. Maybe that was, for the time being, a goal of international community so that they can control area by creating permanent instability. And for all of you who listen to me now and say, oh my God, where does this come from? Well, this comes from the same strategy as the Western powers applied to Middle East. So Balkans as a geopolitical, geostrategic area is kept in the same way as a area of permanent instability, and Kosovo and Bosnia and Herzegovina fit into this paradigm because both are internally divided, especially for Kosovo. There was no reason to, after Serb forces had to leave Kosovo, there was no reason to keep northern Kosovo separated in this sort of way, which actually constitutes the permanent division, internal division of Kosovo. I think I said too much, and I think most of the thing is quite new and maybe in discontinuity what you heard today, but at least it's a good moment to start discussion, which we will continue tomorrow when we talk about geopolitics of the Balkans in post-Yugoslav era. That's enough from me.
Can I just add something? I would say that Balkan Muslims and Islam are secular Islam, it's a European Islam. And I think that most of the Europeans were not aware of this fact. They judge Muslims in the region according to what they have in their own states. Muslims coming from Asia or Middle East, it's quite different from what Balkan Muslims are. But on the other side, as there was this nationalism which was really growing, Muslims apparently as a nation in Bosnia, they also became nationalistic. And this is, Islam was not as a religion, but as something that served as a basis for their rise of nationalism. So it was, I think, misjudged, because all these nations in the region were some kind of nationalistic mood, because this was the only way how to build up new states and to resist Serbian aggression. So this was a normal reaction. And I would say that very often you can hear people saying they're all nationalists. They are, you know, and this is a way in relativizing the Serbian responsibility for starting the war. And interpretation here in Serbia, despite the fact of ICY work or ICJ or any other national courts, is that this was liberation war Serbs, especially in Bosnia. And, you know, they don't take into consideration or as a basis for dialogue about what has happened, any findings of any international court. They develop their own understanding. And I can say there is an enormous contribution of the intellectual elite and academia in sort of a semantic disinterpretation. And the new generations in Serbia are brought up on this model of denial. So denial, I would say, is growing proportionally to revelation of documents and all that has been collected in the ICY and elsewhere. So I would say that the Serbian nation is frustrated and defeated, and that a lot of these isolated because it's not able to deal with its with the legacy of the war, and Serbia turned to Russia. Russia stepped in very intensively after financial crisis 2008, but became very very active in the region, especially in Serbia 2013-14, mostly with the soft power, which apparently was based on orthodoxy, on these traditional values, which are lost in the West and so on. So it was more, I would say, emotional. And Russia supported the Serbian interpretation of the wars. And one thing more, and many of Jeffrey and Nana know about it, Serbia issued 18 or 19 indictments against Bosnian leadership, claiming the Bosnian leadership, Bosniak leadership, started the war against the Yugoslav army in Bosnia. And this was many of these people, like Vranic and Divjak and some others, were arrested along the Serbian warrant. Vranic in London, and he was there taken to the court. Fortunately enough, friends of Bosnia and were helping hand in to the court, and the judge who was presiding over the case rejected all Serbian claims. But this in a way shows that Serbia is continuously trying to undermine all these international courts dealing with the situation in Yugoslavia in the 90s. But this is still active. These warrants are still active. And many, like Divjak, Jovan Divjak was arrested in Vienna, who was a Serbian general on Bosniak side. So, and this is still active. Like the Kosovo court, Serbs expect for Kosovo court to indict all the whole leadership of Liberation Army, and this is their argument to prove that it is a mafia and criminal state, therefore its status is negotiable. It's not to be recognized as independent state. So there are all kinds of manipulations, I would say very skillful manipulations from the side of Belgrade, whereas Kosovo and Bosnia are not up to it because they didn't invest the energy, for example, in revision of their lawsuit against Serbia for genocide and aggression. And even during the first trial, they were not enough engaged in proving what Serbia did. Somehow there was this notion that the world knows what happened and that things will develop naturally, which doesn't happen like that in front of the court. And they lost, I mean, they didn't lose the case. Serbia is found guilty for not preventing the genocide, but still Serbia with this judgment behaves as if there was nothing of responsibility on her side. The same thing.
I'm going to stop you again, Sonja. Yes. To give us a break. And we're going to come to the end of your presentation soon with questions and answers. But the very important cultural reality you propose, that Bosnia expects the world to know what happened and therefore it doesn't have to take any steps to prove it. I want to ask our Kosovo members if they feel something similar may have been happening in respect to their country. Or not. From an outsider's point of view, with the development of this specialist court, which if it brings cases will have a profoundly damaging effect on the record of Kosovo Albanians in and following the conflict of 98-99, so far the Kosovo state has done nothing to correct the record. And I wonder if Sonja's very important point that you've just heard. Ama, you're usually thoughtful about these matters. Well, all of you Kosovars are thoughtful, but I'm going to Ama first. Do you think there's anything in that point for you? Does Kosovo expect the truth to emerge without doing anything about it?
First of all, we know that immediately after the war, we have a different institution who deal with war crimes cases and prosecuting them, and we have parallel domestic courts which are prosecuting these cases. This is nothing new that special court, which has established now, will deal with war crime cases. But through this way, I think the Serbia can achieve the goal to prosecute the leaders who were involved in the war, KLA leaders. But in other hand, for Kosovo, for Albania, for example, for Kosovo state, it's very difficult to prosecute the leaders, the law commanders from police or military who live in Serbia, because there is no cooperation. And this is the main problem now.
Okay, but Lorena, do you think more generally than just looking at different court processes, do you think Kosovo generally, in your lifetime, where you've grown to learn about the history, do you think that you've been aware of your country trying to set its own record? Or do you think it's worked on the basis that everybody must know what happened, even though I can tell you they don't?
I don't know if I got the question correctly, but back at the time when the law of establishing the specialist court has been approved in the parliament, there was a division in population. Some of us basically believe that the specialist court, the establishment of specialist court, is the right decision, mainly because it will filtrate the KLA and it's war for liberation. And by filtration, I mean some of them who did, who conducted war crimes.
Okay, yeah, I understand that. And I'm going to ask Sonja about that immediately afterwards, but forget the courts.
Yeah, okay.
Do you think your country generally expects the world to know what happened, right, wrong, so far as the KLA is concerned? Or do you think it's been active in advancing its own understanding of its own history?
Definitely not the second one. And it's mainly because of the transitioning phase that we have been through as a state. So I think now is the right time basically to ask for the truth and to show the world the truth. But since now we haven't progressively done nothing about it. I mean, not nothing, but.
Yes, Sonja, thank you very much. Sonja, do you have a great deal of experience of Kosovo. Do you think that they are advancing their history? And I'm sorry to interrupt your flow, but do you think they are advancing their history? Or do you think they are letting the world do it for them? And what do you think about this specialist court?
Well, I think that, first of all, Kosovars have relied on America immensely, and they expected that America would solve all the problems, which now showed at this very juncture that things don't function like that, because great powers always have their different, their interests at different times, which may exclude Kosovars or whoever. So therefore, this special court, this came as a result of Carlo Del Ponte book and Dick Marty's report. I think international community has a great responsibility for that, because after 2000, the Kosovars didn't have any institution that they controlled. Everything was controlled by UN and ULEX. And unfortunately, these actors didn't gather any base of what has happened, though there were many reports by Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, and many other organizations, which pointed out to this non-Albanian, to violations against the non-Albanian population. But, and this is, this exists, but, and it was not taken care by the internationals who dominated the Kosovo courts. There was this hybrid court, which apparently didn't contribute or didn't work properly. So I think now that the special court exists, it would be very important to sort of be fair about the whole case and not use it politically, because at this moment it seems though it was a welcome intervention to stop this meeting in Washington, but on the other side it was also, it's it's very controversial the way they have revealed the indictment, which was not confirmed by judges. But we'll see how it will continue and whether the case will develop along the lines of indictment. But however, I think that it's important for Kosovo society to acknowledge these violations of the Serb population, though many of them have participated in all kinds of activities during this period. But still, I think especially missing people who are humanitarian or human, very important aspects for the families, because this is a continuous pressure on all governments in the region to find the missing people. So I think it's important, despite all these sufferings and experiences that Kosovo has went through, it's important to make a record of what has happened to the other side in Kosovo. And I think this is especially very important for future normalization of the relations between Serbs and Albanians in Kosovo itself. I don't think there's much that's happening in this direction among two communities, because Belgrade is the main negotiator, and Belgrade instrumentalized Kosovo Serbs for its own interests, not for the interests of the Serbian community in Kosovo.
Sonja, thank you for that. And sorry to have derailed your program. I wonder if you could come fairly quickly to a conclusion, because I see the questions are backing up and I want people to be able to ask you the questions they're writing about. So back to you, but if you could come to a conclusion fairly soon.
The whole thing? Well, what I really wanted to pass over the fact that despite all these international agreements, international interventions, reality in these states, especially in Serbia, depends on what society itself is able to deliver. When we talk about Serbia denying its responsibility and kinds of support for civil society and so on, which exists and which do something, in fact, without active participation of Serbian elites, it's not possible to change the cultural matrix of the society. So it's, and I think the international community was not tough, but was not really referring to this cultural model which enabled Serbia to have this very wide support of the society for the project that was carried on in the 90s and which is still active, unfortunately. So this cultural model, I would say, is so extremely important. It's not only about political elites. It's not about Vučić or Dodik. It's really the state strategy which exists so long and which has been, which changed over the time, which adapted to new realities, but it was always there. So in order to change this, main focus of Serbian society, it's necessary to change the cultural model, the educational system, in order to create new critical mass or new generation, which will be able to deal with this issue long-term. So this is my conclusion.
Thank you very much, Sonja. I see amongst others, Carol has asked two questions. Perhaps you'd like to ask them yourself, Carol, because Sonja won't have been able to read them. One at a time, maybe. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, Sonja. The first one was, I just wondered, what do you think, how important for Vučić and for the Serbian government is it that they get into the EU? And if it was made an absolute condition that Serbia recognize Kosovo in order to enter the EU, would this influence Vučić, or are his interests lying maybe more towards Russia and China, or a combination?
Serbia is not EU. Serbia is not truly EU.
Sonja, I don't know if I'm the only one, but you're...
Not only Vučić,
Sonja,
previous President Tadić and all the others, they really played.
Sonja, I'm sorry to bother you, but I think your signal is being distorted. It may improve.
I don't hear you. What did you say?
Your signal is being distorted. Could you just try turning off the video and leaving the... Turn the video off and it may strengthen the audio signal. Thank you.
Should I take off the video?
Just take off the video. Yes, please. Yeah. Thank you. And then answer the question.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah, that's better. President Savic
and the others, they were all not... Do you hear me?
Yep.
Do you hear me?
Yes, I hear you.
Okay, they were not truly EU-oriented. And I would say this this resistance to face the past, Serbia has become very autistic over the years because in order to normalize regions, not only with Kosovo, but in the region, it's necessary to sort of open up the past issues and deal with that. And Serbia is not ready for that. So instead, Serbia turned to the east, to Russia especially, and now China and others. And they have so-called foreign policy, which is not a foreign policy, based on four pillars, US, EU, China, and Russia. But as you can see, constant change of international context, like this last event when they annulled this meeting in Washington, immediately affected Vučić's position. He was at that time in Brussels. He realized that EU is the only side which he can rely on for any serious help in every respect. So he said, I'm ready to negotiate the new strategy of enlargement, which was proposed by Macron and so on. At the beginning, they were silent about it. So I would say that new reality will show that Serbia has no alternative but EU, and Russia is not investing. Russia has this soft power, emotional and civilizational maybe. China is also very rational about it, and it very much depends how COVID pandemia will affect these states in their behavior towards Balkans. Balkans were just the theater of their confrontation and gaining certain points, but realistically, they don't really see Serbia, they don't really follow or pursue Serbia's interests. But Serbia is skillfully manipulating that. How long it will be, so I'm not sure, because things are changing quite quickly. And reality is teaching us that our interests are in the region and in the EU. So this is something that will come slowly, I suppose.
Now, Karol, I don't know if that meets your question. And ask a supplementary if you like, or otherwise move to your second question, which is about COVID-19.
Yeah, well, it was just to confirm what Sonja was saying for the first one. So as I understand it, Serbia's main interest, as Vučić and the government see it, is in membership of the EU or simply support of the EU?
It is, first of all, support, because full membership means an end to the project.
Yeah.
Of the Serbian project, aspirations in the region. And this is one of the main causes. Serbia will become the EU once they give up the Milosevic's project. So this is quite clear.
COVID?
Yeah, I was just reading recently about the situation in Novi Pazar, which is mainly Bosniak populated. And the situation with COVID-19 is getting more and more serious. They don't have the medical support that they should have. And the medical situation in Novi Pazar has apparently been deteriorating for many years. And I just wonder whether Vučić feels that he can ignore it. They have sent some kind of help to Novi Pazar, but the people there are feeling that that's just damage limitation. It's not enough. Well, I'm just wondering whether Vučić feels that it's important to do more, or can he more or less ignore them
Both Bosniaks and Albanians in the south were neglected through over all these years. And there was this, in my view, this kind of administrative cleansing, all kinds of administrative obstructions. Secondly, there was no true investment in these regions. But unfortunately, whole Serbia is neglected. So, but these regions even more. So regarding the COVID situation in Sandžak, it's really very severe, dire. And now they have received the support from help from Turkey and Sarajevo. At the beginning, Vučić rejected support and help from Sarajevo, but now it's there. But Belgrade, I would say, is epicenter of that now, and they don't come up with true figures. So this is really an explosion of pandemia without true insight how far it goes. And mostly young people are affected because many of them started to lead nightlife, you know, the gatherings, the football matches, and so on. And this was just in the period when the election campaign was there, and somehow Vučić allowed this to happen. So now we are in a situation which we don't really know. There are many warning signs by experts who are not in this state team, who sort of point out how fight went, and it's beyond the control at the moment.
Thank you. Nothing supplementary, Carol, in which case Francesca, you had a question.
Yes, I had a question concerning the returns, because you mentioned, I don't remember exactly what you said, but you said that it was very difficult to return to their former town, and they were instead returning to their ethnic republic, like the Federation or Republika Srpska. And I wanted to ask, because I read an article that actually Bosnia is a success story in the regard that a lot of people managed to get back into their own property. So my question was, to what extent was it a success or a failure that people could return?
Well, we have now two problems. One is really true return to those places. They did return the property, but the law was passed because it was forced on them. But many people send their property. And secondly, is that many people leave the region, not only Bosnia, but Serbia, Croatia, and so on. So the region is... now lacking, especially the middle generation, which will be able to carry on. And in Serbia here, we have total gap in generations which will be able to reform Serbia. And Bosnia is in the same situation. So the return of refugees is finished as a process. It's now individual problem whether people want to return or not. But as a state program, it's finished. Like in Croatia, we were involved very much with the return of Serbs to Croatia, Kosovo, and other parts. And, you know, at the beginning, it was obstructed by everybody. The state, Serbia state, Croatian state, international community. Nobody wanted the return of refugees. We were the only organization dealing with that. So it also shows how everybody accepted ethnic division. And this, and like in north of Kosovo. North of Kosovo is wired of Albanians, because there were also Albanians in Kosovska Mitrovica. And of course, you have these enclaves of Serbs throughout Kosovo, who live on their own, and it's not communication. But I think Serbs of Kosovo have more problems now with Belgrade than Pristina, because Belgrade is centralizing them, and they depend on their on salaries which Belgrade is providing for education system or health system and so on. So apparently, there is no potential among these people to resist these policies of ethnification, ethnic politics.
Arif, did you have something you wanted to add to the question of refugees? Somebody's not got their phone muted. I think it's Naina, but I'm not sure. Arif.
The only thing to add are the constitutional provisions in Bosnia, which in theory said everybody can return to their pre-war homes, but it also provided an option for compensation to be provided for people who didn't want to return to their homes. But of course, the question of whether you do or do not want to return to your home is a question having a number of different factors. One is, how do you return to a place where there may be alleged war criminals there who committed crimes against you? How do you return to a place where there's no police force that's ethnically diverse that might protect you? How do you move to a town or a village where there may be nobody else of your ethnicity or group there? So there are many, many factors that do not give you a genuine choice of return. And I believe the figure is about roughly 1 million people did not return to their pre-war homes. And remember that Bosnia is a country of 4 million, so that's a huge percentage of people that didn't. They may well have received the compensation that was available to them, But the consequence of that is obviously very real, because if you look at Republika Srpska, the vast majority of people in towns and villages that were very ethnically diverse, if they hadn't returned, you then get a majority Serb area, which then means that translates into the politics, which means you get unified position on the policy areas. So in a way, Republika Srpska as an entity is very successful, because the policy of ethnic cleansing was in a way practically achieved, even if the law says it shouldn't have. And that means that decision making is very streamlined. It's very efficient as an entity. It can make decisions that the Federation simply can't with the same level of efficiency and progress. And therefore, in a way, it can function as a parallel entity very, very successfully, and may well do so in the future. And that's a lesson for all states, probably going back all the way to Germany and the Holocaust, that if you ethnically cleanse your territory and you homogenize it, the politics do become easier, sadly. And Sonja, that's a horrible lesson to take.
Sonja, do you agree with that? We are seeing a shedding.
I don't think Republika Srpska, because there is another phase after you have achieved an ethnic state. It becomes self-destructive, because you always look for the enemies. So the enemies are becoming disloyal people within the country. So there is never ending process of self-destruction, you know. So I don't think this is a solution. And Republika Srpska is not a successful entity. It's in severe, more severe situation than Federation, despite all the help that it gets from Belgrade, and it survives on the help of Belgrade. So I think this, especially Bosnia, is not only Bosnian question, it's European question. Whether Europe really wants ethnic states in the center, in the heart of the Europe. This is the real question.
Two questions from Faridin, then Naina, and then Naina will bring today's session to a close. Faridin.
Thank you, Jeff. Sonja, I have two questions for you, actually. War crimes happened in Croatia and BiH, as well as in Kosovo, and these ought to be recognized. Do you think that the current politicians in the Serbia are ready to admit what happened in this area of the European Union, and at least to apologize the Croatian, Bosniak and Albanians from Kosovo? Or you think that they are not ready to do, having in mind that the current president of the Serbia actually was in the regime of Milošević minister to him? And my second question is, if you wanted to do it later or right now?
To do what?
Question, or to leave it first?
Okay, no, I'll answer the first question.
Okay.
I think none of the Serbian leaders are ready to apologize. There were some apologies made by Tadic, but this was not true. I think it takes time. And I think real reconciliation or normalization of relations takes time. It's transgenerational process. But what is important is that Serbian elites now, political elites, especially the one that are occupying the Serbian, are in power now, Napredna Stranka and the others, they're part of Milošević's Milošević's project. They were very active leaders at that time, very instrumental for the project. And now they are supposed to apologize to the region. I don't think they're mature enough to do that. And especially having in mind this process of denying and relativizing everything that has happened. And in this context, you have so many books and films and whatever, which are proving and cementing this line of denial in Serbian society. So I don't see potential there. What I think should be done is really to focus more on educational process system, and this cultural changing of cultural matrix. This is something that I think EU should help. And unfortunately, in this EU negotiations, education system takes only one day or two. This is the chapter which which is immediately open and closed. Nobody cares about that. It's really about the values. And nobody, EU is not, now for the first time they have mentioned that they are going to monitor how the European values are being implied in these societies, which they didn't do so far. It was all, on the paper, simulating all kinds of strategies, programs, and so on. But in fact, they have never checked what is behind that. And maybe they know, but they didn't react or they didn't complain about practices in Serbia. So I think this is really a long-term process, long-term.
Faridin, your second question, and then Nena.
Yeah. Actually, recently, the High Representative of EU, Mr. Barella, in a meeting with the German officials, said, we must keep our goal of bringing the Western Balkan states to the EU, but the European diplomacy must make a profilization of the states, Western Balkans, that are really interested in integration to the EU family and those who are heading towards the Moscow. My question is, do you think that this double game, if I may call it, of Mr. Vucic will win in the end? Because with one hand, he wants to integrate in the EU. In another hand, he wants to keep still this good relationship and traditional relationship with the Russians. What is your opinion on this issue?
Well, I said it already. I think that Serbia is not sincere about EU membership as long as it's persistent on its project, Milosevic's project. So it's very much connected. So they think with the EU membership, they would not be able to aspire to Bosnia, Kosovo, Montenegro. And Russia is a partner which will always exist. So it only depends how you regulate its relations. And I think Serbia is playing this game, Vucic itself, because you know, they always tell to the Western partners that Russia is putting pressure on them and so on. Russia is also playing its game vis-a-vis West, not Serbia. And therefore, I think things will change between EU and Russia. And I think Germany's role is extremely important. And I think both Kosovars and Belgrade have underestimated Germany's role now and in the future.